Welcome, welcome, folks. Got a quick one here for you tonight. Gonna talk about maybe our favorite speech from our favorite play from Shakespeare, and that is gonna be the Tomorrow, Tomorrow soliloquy. And we thought it'd be kind of fun if we checked out that soliloquy as done by five famous actors and did some reactions in comparison and contrast and call it a day after that. Stick around. Welcome back, folks. So in scene 5 of Act 5 of Macbeth, Macbeth is famously told by Satan, which, what a name, the queen, my lord, is dead. And Macbeth responds, she should have died hereafter. There would have been time for such a word. Tomorrow, and tomorrow, and tomorrow, creeps in this petty pace from day to day to the last syllable of recorded time. And all our yesterdays have lighted fools the way to dusty death. Out, out, brief candle. Life's but a walking shadow, a poor player that struts and frets his hour upon the stage and then is heard no more. It is a tale told by an idiot, full of sound and fury, signifying nothing. So that was me just reading it, but I want you to see the difference from when you just hear somebody read it, because reading Shakespeare aloud, it's, you know, it helps you kind of get a sound of the word, but it's so hard to deliver and execute while reading aloud.
Where to stress,
yeah,
and where to really...
And you're going to see that these actors, as we cross-compare, they stress and don't stress tons of different things, and there may be some that maybe have a better handle on how to portray this than others. And we'll leave it up to you guys and give your judgment. Maybe you can give a ranking. which one do you want to dive into first, Brady?
I will just, it'll be random, I suppose. It'll just be the order that I happen to have searched them. So we'll just go down the line here and get our honest reaction.
You want to start with Denzel or end with Denzel?
I was going to just go to this one. I won't have Denzel first. So we'll start with Fassbender first, I guess.
Okay, so this is 2015 Macbeth by Justin, I forget his last name. You know, this movie chops a lot of Macbeth out, and there's some faults and stuff with the movie, but overall I think it captures the mood really well. And I think Fassbender and Cotillard do a pretty good job if you can get past Cotillard's accent.
She should have died hereafter. There would have been a time for such a word. Tomorrow. And tomorrow. And tomorrow. Creeps in this petty pace from day to day to the last syllable of recorded time. And all our yesterdays have lighted fools the way to dusty death. Out. Out. Brief candle. Life's but a walking shadow, a poor player that struts and frets his hour upon the stage and then is heard no more. It is a tale told by an idiot, full of sound and fury, signifying nothing.
So that was number one there.
So, you know, Fassbender's super talented, right? Don't much care for the direction of that. Like, when we're getting the most, like, epic part of the lines where he's saying, you know, it's a tale told by an idiot full of sound and fury. It's like a total nihilistic dismissal of all of life and all of the world, you know, that history might be chaotic and things don't make sense, like we were mentioning in our Sydney video, that, you know, that's when the director chose to cut to that random guy's face. Like, why weren't we zoomed in on Macbeth's face when he's given the most important lines? And to the point where, at the end, he's still saying this stuff all kind of casually and whisper while he's carrying somebody. I don't know about you, but have you ever tried to whisper poetry while carrying somebody? It comes, hold on, told by, hold on, sound and, all right, upsy-daisy. Like,
how many times have you carried someone and done poetry? No. Trying to get into character here.
not as much as Fassbender, apparently, because he's a pro. And yeah, a little too much of the sensibility that we need to make this into real speech and not keep it Shakespearean. Mm. And so, you know, there's all these Marlon Brando-like pauses. Tomorrow. And tomorrow.
Yeah, it's very whispery.
And, like, at some point, he's just trying to make it, like, people don't like portraying Shakespeare on film because it's this big chunk of words. You get this big old word vomit from each character, and you don't get, like, in our day and age, I say something, then you say something, then I say something, then you say something, and then when I say something profound, I just say something, and then we get a music montage. Like, back then, you know, characters would expound for a few sentences, and so when you see movies get turned, or when Shakespeare plays get turned into movies, they'll totally get chopped up. And that Macbeth is probably the worst version of chopping stuff out, because there's things that they chop out, like, wholesale.
Oh, really?
Just so many lines are streamlined. That said, once you get over that hump, I do think that that's actually a pretty neat little Macbeth movie.
Like, I do like it's actually set in Scotland.
Yeah.
Not that
the, and it's and it's got film. This medieval Scotland feel. Yeah. Like, everybody else, like, you'll see later in the Polanski one, when they do it medieval, it looks like high medieval. It's all knights and armor, and it's like, no, I want to see that rustic, old kind of nomadic heath step people, that, you know, old school Scotland. And yeah, it definitely has that vibe, so it's kind of cool.
Yeah.
Let's see. Here
next,
we go.
Next one, we have Patrick Stewart as Macbeth.
All right. This one's from 2010. This one's a BBC rendition. BBC did a bunch of awesome Shakespeare ones with the Hollow Crown series in, like, the mid-2010s. They also did a really awesome King Lear. I thought this one was going to be as awesome. Nah, they hadn't quite fully figured out the formula. And a lot of those, they do these cool, like, modernizing thing or how to... This one's kind of sloppily done. It feels a little cheaper. Does not feel as near as epic or cool as the Hollow Crown or the Anthony Hopkins King Lear. You can feel that they're starting to work towards something like that, but yeah, this one's a little silly, a little over the top. It's all super modern era, and it's a little clunky. But that said, let's see what we think of Stewart in this monologue.
Wherefore was that cry?
The queen, my lord, is dead.
She should have died hereafter. There would have been a time for such a word. Last syllable of recorded time. And all our yesterdays of lighted fools the way to dusty death. Out. Out. Brief candle. Life's but a walking shadow. A poor player that struts and frets his hour upon the stage. And then is heard no more. It is a tale told by an idiot, full of sound and fury, signifying nothing.
So what do you think so far? Like, I've seen all of these before, and I've seen them multiple times. I've seen the whole actual movies. Now that we're just too deep, what do you think of Fassbender or Stewart so far, or just the productions or any of it?
Yeah, like I said, the Fassbender one, I like the look of it. But yeah, I don't know, it's just, maybe just because we're so primed to hear the words that it doesn't carry over like I would kind of hope or thought it will, but I don't know, there's two out of five here, and they're very whispery, is like it, very much of it, and not to say that's not what I would picture, but I don't know, it's not, I don't know, it doesn't,
it's really, not grabbing you.
I
don't think it's grabbed me either. Maybe I should have brought my Charles Lamb with me, but like Charles Lamb, who I've referenced before, he's a writer from the 1800s, he's romantic poet kind of guy, but he's a big Shakespeare fan, and he has this whole essay that's like, the tragedies should not be put on stage. Like, do not try and stage those. Those are meant to be read. Shakespeare is not meant to be acted. It's meant to be read. It's because you've already read it. You've heard in your head what that speech is. You've heard it. You've seen it in your head. And now, when you go and you watch these guys, they're only giving you one thin version of all these versions in your head of the possibilities of how to read it. And so at some point, like, it is going to be decidedly underwhelming. That said, like, I don't know. I agreed with that until I saw Hopkins do the King Lear thing. And then after I saw Hopkins do the King Lear thing, I was like, man, I got to check out more of these. These are, when you get somebody that actually just gets it, like, it takes it to a new level. And so I'd say to some extent, I don't think Stewart got it. Like, no. Or his director didn't, because that signifying
nothing.
Nothing. Like, and, you know, just that whole giant long pause in before the start of the monologue, and then, like, hold up, wait, we got a body coming in. Wheel the body. And it's like, was that the queen? Like, I assume so. But, like, Why did we need this big long pause? Why all the pauses between each one? And even his delivery was decidedly kind of this repetitive pattern where, and so I don't know, like that felt more like somebody who got a fart out than somebody whose wife just died. Like,
talk real slow.
Okay.
Be very careful.
Yeah.
With each word. As to not,
and like, I think very highly of Patrick Stewart. He's in The Hollow Crown, and he's awesome in the Richard II play as John of Gaunt. He's been great before and after that. I just didn't think that was a very good rendition. It was a little. Even the guy that opened it up, the Queen, my lord, is dead, murdered. No, I don't know that. Just dead, though. Like, you know? So, not loving the first two. Let's see what this next one does for us. This next one is maybe the most recent that we're going to at least show. Maybe we should try and find a clip of Daniel Craig doing it from the recent Broadway. But sans that, the most recent big popular version of Macbeth is the A24 film version from 2018, from 2021, starring Denzel Washington and directed by Joel Cohen, and it's got some other sort of big names in it. From Fargo. Why am I blanking on her name? She's Joel Cohen's wife. I'll remember her name after the clip. Directed by Joel Cohen, whose wife is Frances McDormand, who stars in a lot of his or their movies. And she is playing Lady Macbeth alongside Denzel Washington in a more boomer cut. This is my boomer cut. Because Macbeth, and, you know, Marion Cotillard and Fassbender, they're young, they're hip, they're hot, they're cool, They're, 30-ish, sexy, they're looking good. Now, not but a few years later, we go from having the young Gen Xer to the old boomer Macbeth, so... We'll let Denzel Academy Award winner take over from here.
He should have died hereafter. There would have been a time for such a word. Tomorrow. And tomorrow and tomorrow. Creeps in this petty pace from day to day to the last syllable of recorded time. And all our yesterdays have lighted fools the way to dusty death. Out. Out, brief candle. Life is but a walking shadow. A poor player that struts and frets his hour upon the stage and then is heard no more. It is a tale. By an idiot, full of sound and fury, signifying nothing.
Okay.
if you could see me in the little bottom right thumbnail, I forgot we were being tracked as we watched this. Yeah, that was a good reaction. didn't love what was happening with Fassbender. Didn't love what Stewart was doing, but. Some things in this scene were just downright laughable.
Yeah, they were pretty goofy.
The lady sprawled at the bottom of the stairs. That's hilarious. to me, more than anything, I don't think Denzel Washington has any idea what's happening in that speech. Furthermore, he just feels completely lost with what to do with his own accent. He's made a living off of doing this softened urban accent where he can speak in an urbanized slang, but it's still enunciative enough for the general white boomer audience to get. And so he wants to do that, and he gets parts of the movie where he does do that, but you could tell within the scene there he moved away from it as it went on. He got into a higher pitch and he talked faster. And he enunciated, and by the end, he almost had a quasi-transatlantic accent. His accent's kind of, it's very subtly so, but it's slurring throughout the thing. And, it's because, and you can see this, this isn't the first time he's done Shakespeare. You can see this in his Much Ado About Nothing. He plays, who's the bad guy in Much Ado About Nothing? But it's got Keanu Reeves, Kenneth Branagh, Emma Thompson, bunch of big-time names. If not for Keanu Reeves, Denzel Washington would have been laughed out of Hollywood. But Keanu Reeves unfortunately made people think that Denzel Washington was capable of doing Shakespeare in relative turns. Keanu Reeves is unwatchable in that movie. Me and my roommate had turned it off, and I decided if we were going to rewatch it, we would have to automatically skip through any scene with Keanu Reeves in it. It's that bad.
It's not even redeemable for its awfulness.
Otherwise the movie's pretty watchable. It's pretty good.
For its own sort of novelty or
people should be making TikTok memes out of it or something. Yeah, absolutely. But yeah, unfortunately, too much of Keanu Reeves and Denzel Washington, and unfortunately their two characters are together often, and it's Oh, I gotta listen to both of them in the same scene. But the point being, Denzel doesn't know what to do with his accent in that movie either. In this one, he definitely tones it down and tries to go much more middle-of-the-road American and tries to just be very enunciative.
What's even the setting of that version of the movie? Because it's like, I mean, it's all black and white and
it's,
sort of like...
you know, German impressionist or expressionistic or whatever. It's...
kind of nondescript-y.
Yeah. M.C. Escher painting or drawing. Yeah, I don't know. like, and, you know... Denzel Washington tomorrow. And tomorrow! Yeah. And tomorrow, like... okay,
That's when you can go rewind and Chance is, like, on the floor, like, laughing.
So the last recorded... line. Syllable. Like, what was... why pause between recorded and syllable? Like, I get a small pause to emphasize syllable, or maybe emphasize each syllable and syllable, but it was just this nondescript pause where he was like maybe clearing his throat or getting his breath or literally remembering the line, and they didn't want to keep reshooting the take and this was the best take they could get. That's what it feels like to me. And so, you know, there's parts in it he did pretty decent with the Dusty Death line, but otherwise, yeah,
yeah, between the cuts of him talking and just, like, Francis McDormand just, like, lying on the ground.
And it's, like, just regardless of how exactly he delivers his lines, like, just looking at his body language and his tone and what that character's supposed to be portraying in that moment, like, what kind of tone do you get? With Fassbender, you got this tone where he was kind of manic when he came in the room and then he was told she's dead, and all of a sudden that's all he's thinking about. And it's like this kind of, I was hot, now I'm cold. Mm-hmm. So you understand what's happening with his character and who his character is. With Patrick Stewart, you understood that it was, like I said, it was kind of, oh, just a fart. He didn't like the queen. He's, you know, maybe glad she's gone. Maybe he's not happy about the terms that it's happened on. But you can tell through his character that it's like, it's not even the queen being gone. It's the fact that his whole kingdom's falling apart. The fact that he let her die. The fact that they're in this place that they are. That's why everything's all going to crap. But, like, you can get that through his character's presentation. And it's at some point, it's trying to present... I have no idea what Denzel's presenting other than, like, sad dad genes. Like, oh, my kid or somebody died and they're at the bottom of a stairs. And, oh, shucks, that's too bad. That's bad. That's... tomorrow, like, you know, and so it's like, was that the emotion that Joel Cohen wanted? Like, this isn't just on Denzel, this is more on Joel. Like, as much as we were kind of, you know, critiquing the other two directorial things, what is Joel trying to portray here? This is atrocious. Like, spoiler alert, folks, I don't like that movie. But let's see, maybe we can find a better version. Like, so far, would you say we're 0 for 3 here?
Yeah, as far as memorable, you know...
portrayals of that, yeah.
Fassbender's probably still my favorite as of these.
And, yeah,
You know, maybe if Patrick Stewart was in, you know, the proper setting...
Can we go to... I know we got McKellen up, but can we go to Brannig next? Because I think we got to save McKellen for last. That's my 2 cents. We would do the Alan Cumming one, but that is only on audiobook, and I feel like it's only fair if we get the visual and audio together to be fully fair to all the actors considered. That said, you should totally check out Alan Cumming's monologue on the audiobook. It's fantastic. Yeah, this one. And so this is... some kind of theatrical event. It's not a big budget event, I don't think. But this is Kenneth Branagh, resident Universal Shakespearean filmmaker, who I've got mixed feelings about. I think he does pretty well as Iago in Othello, but ironically that's when he's not directing himself. I don't much care for his Hamlet. He's pretty good as is it Benedict? In Much Ado About Nothing? Yeah, I think it's Benedict. And so, he's really good at giving out quick, witty banter and having ironic tones, but he struggles when he has to do more serious characters, I find. I feel like he does really good with the Barabbas-type ironic tone to it, sort of thing. So, think when he does Gilderoy Lockhart and Harry Potter.
Yeah.
Right. Okay, that's okay. He kills it. Right?
Yeah. Exactly.
Tomorrow. And tomorrow and tomorrow creeps in this petty pace from day to day to the last syllable of recorded time. And all our yesterdays have lighted fools the way to dusty death. Out! Out! Brief candle! Life's but a walking shadow, a poor player that struts and frets his hour upon the stage and then is heard no more. It is a tale told by an idiot full of sound and fury, signifying
so, yeah, that one,
kind of more sad dad jeans, if to use your terminology.
Yeah, way overacted set. That's Jim. Yes, that's yes. Jim Carrey doing. Yeah. You know, like
I saw him like French. I don't know what he was doing himself to make himself like tear up.
Yeah, he started crying and drooling. The waterworks were coming out. He also did the big pause before nothing. But you could tell what he was trying to do. He at least in that one was like, It wasn't just sad dad jeans. It was like, you know, devastated. His wife has died.
Yes.
And he's like almost devastated with it because this whole time he's been, you can kind of tell he's been telling himself, I don't care about her. That's not why I'm in this. I don't care. And all of a sudden it's all come crashing down. That's why he goes from tomorrow to all of a sudden he can't talk. And so you can get that in his portrayal. That's where his character motivation's coming from. So as ridiculously over the top as it is, I still get what's happening. I still get where he's coming from. But yeah, super overacted. That's even more overacted than some of the other stuff that he does. But you can tell that overacting, it lends itself better to these over the top characters. Like I said, like Barabbas or Iago, or especially Iago, where Iago does get moments where he undercuts that and he gets kind of serious, and like it's just the perfect amount of seriousness, because Macbeth's such a serious character. The play itself can have some comic overtones, but the Macbeth character himself is a pretty serious character, except for when he's going crazy. You can maybe laugh at him, but you're not gonna laugh at him when he's crying over his wife's death, you know. So, here we go, folks. Here's maybe the original, the OG himself, Sir Ian McKellen. We've had a lot of, these are all big-time actors. Like, none of these guys are slouches by any means as far as their, like, acting credentials go. But this guy is sort of maybe the most famous for playing Macbeth, and he, like, literally wrote the book on it, and the fact that, like, he's given classes, conventions, maybe even has written a book on how to portray Shakespeare, how to enunciate, how that ties in with poetry and meter, how figurative language plays into it, like how you can look at the beginning words of lines to tie those together to get a gist for how the lines are going to flow, or how to look at the ending words to get, like, because that's the stamp point hit. So if you guys get time, go check out Ian McKellen's got a little 10-minute video. It's some acting clip studio thing he did. But he goes through this monologue and he goes line by line and sort of does some annotations for people. And he suggests how and why people should read what and where, and where and how you can emote your own emotions to get the images to do the work and all that kind of stuff. And so,
that's cool.
Yeah. Clearly, the guy understands what he's reading. So maybe this one might do a little better. We'll see.
Wherefore was that cry?
The queen, my lord, is dead.
She should have died hereafter. There would have been a time for such a word. Tomorrow. And tomorrow. And tomorrow. Creeps in this petty pace from day to the last syllable of recorded time. And all our yesterdays have lighted fools the way to dusty death. Out, out, brief candle. Life is but a walking shadow. A poor player that struts and frets his hour upon the stage. And then is heard no more. It is a tale told by an idiot, full of sound and fury, signifying nothing.
So what do you think of that one?
Way more captivating. Still has that pause I noticed at the yeah. end before the nothing. But yeah, overall, just yeah.
Similar
way more
pause
gripping.
After the first tomorrow, too, right? Uh-huh. Almost all of these speeches, like tomorrow, and tomorrow, and tomorrow. And so, like, we get... At some point, I want to say that all these renditions we've watched are so incredibly influenced by McKellen that, like, he's the one that defined how to say this speech, and like, because at some point maybe he's the only one of the people of all the people we've watched that fully understands like when, why, and how to say that speech. And not saying his version's perfect by any means, but that he applied
his
own,
the closest approximation, so
he's
everyone
the only
has
one that
sort
has
of
his own
like
genuine take on it. Yeah, everybody else has to get his take because they need his spark notes in a sense, you know.
Yeah, so maybe they're all unconsciously doing the poor man's McClellan,
yeah.
you know, the whole time, or interesting.
And like, also to be fair to Ian McKellen, like that's from like the 70s, and that's from a filmed version of a stage play, where most of the other ones we watched are actual films where they get takes, and they're all like 2010 or later, like 2010, 2015, 2018, 2021. Those are all much more recent. Those are all in the super post-internet, post-digital age, where there's no reason that those shouldn't look and sound at their absolute best. And especially, those are coming after so many other earlier versions of Macbeth that, like, why do those not sound as good or better than Ian McKellen back in the 70s? Well, I think it's sort of getting at what Charles Lamb's getting at, and I think it's getting at what Philip Sidney says, where it's not that, you know, nobody can do, you know, Shakespeare acting. It's that very few people can actually pull off Shakespeare with acting. And their names are Ian McKellen and Anthony Hopkins, and like, and a very small short list of other people, like, maybe under 100 names.
And it's different in the portrayals, in that when you're reading the line, is he supposed to be saying it loud? Is there supposed to be an audience present? So in the Fassbender one, obviously people see and he's going kind of crazy, and so they're all abhorred about his, like, you know, he's losing his touch on reality. He's dancing with his wife's dead corpse. With the Patrick Stewart one, you know, the nurses just pull out the body, but I don't know if time is frozen and we're just in his head, or if he's saying to these people.
Right.
It seems to indicate, I guess, it's just in his head, because there's no reactions from other people like we get in the Fassbender one.
Right.
And the Denzel, he's obviously just in his own head. Maybe he's talking to
himself. Yeah,
it's
almost like dream space, like we were saying, right? Like,
but for this one, it definitely felt way more internal, and this, yeah, it's like his own...
Yeah, like when you're talking to yourself.
With it.
It felt naturally like somebody talking to themselves.
Yeah, way better than the Denzel one. Which...
Maybe that's a good segue. Do we want to do the John Finch Polanski one?
Yeah, sure.
So if you've never seen 1971 by Roman Polanski, 1971's Macbeth by Roman Polanski, Polanski, one of the great film directors of all time. Not too long after this, he makes Chinatown, which is like a near perfect movie. So it's not like Polanski doesn't know what he's doing, but I personally can't stand this version because Polanski can't seem to find this happy medium where it feels like people are saying the Shakespearean stuff, but it feels natural and it feels organic and it feels like people talking to themselves like McKellen did in that last scene. And so he goes out of his way to turn a lot of the dialogue and monologues into voiceovers. And it's, I don't know, it's a clunky, clunky device that we wouldn't ever try to do now. Clearly, he's trying to be experimental to try and fix some of the things that make Shakespeare difficult to portray in film as versus on stage versus being read. But yeah, it's like unwatchably silly. It's like, you know, Lady and the Tramp when, you know, Lady is like running up to the door and she's talking about Jim Deere and we get this voiceover. Jim never used to do the newspaper like that. But like she doesn't move her mouth. She just perks her head and the voiceover comes in the background. That's what watching this movie's like. So I don't even, this speech may even be in voiceover. I can't remember. Which, I also wanted to point out, by the way, everyone we've seen so far, when they, and maybe including myself when I read this at the start, and all our yesterdays have lighted fools the way to dusty death. Out, out, brief candle. Everybody has said that line, out, out, brief candle. They've just said it. They've just whispered it. But it's... it's the only thing in here that has an exclamation mark. Which I don't know if they got exclamation marks back then or not, but like the only line on here that has an exclamation mark is out, out, brief candle. And so like at some point out, out, that's an imperative statement. So the rest of this is all declarative statements, an imperative statement, a command. And so I wonder if maybe somebody might try to make this speech a little more antic, a little more angry.
That's where I was thinking. I was expecting more anger, as you know, where McClellan kind of hinted that anger towards the end of it.
And I think it's supposed to like show glimpses of anger, and then that anger is swallowed by this nihilistic, fatalistic, I guess I got to give up, you know, signifying nothing. And you can see some of those actors try and get there, but like, they don't get angry enough.
It's more of like, yeah, I thought it'd be more, that's where you should end on the angry notes, and then, yeah, it'll just sort of be of like a seething sort of like, you know,
yeah.
Like, you know, yeah, he's, I don't know, yeah.
And I think that's why McKellen, when he says signifying nothing, he does the nothing, and he like extends it. It's because he doesn't want to finish saying the speech, because finishing saying the speech solidifies what he said is all true, and that, like, He wants to keep holding on to this, like, I can just keep waxing, you know, like, angrier or poetic, and that will keep me from hitting this moment of realization. And then, but in saying that it signifies nothing, he knows that there's nothing more that he can say. He has to stop there. Boom, the realization hits. And so, like, getting to that realization, he tries to take as long as possible. Nothing. And, like, it's really good. And I can tell what he's going for with that kind of acting. And but Denzel, I'm sorry. You can go back to Polanski here.
The Queen, my lord, is dead.
She should have died hereafter. There would have been a time for such a word.
Tomorrow, and tomorrow, and tomorrow, creeps in this petty pace from day to day to the last syllable of recorded time. And all our yesterdays have lighted fools the way to dusty death. Out, out, brief candle. Life's but a walking shadow. Poor player struts and frets his hour upon the stage and then is heard no more. It is a tale told by an idiot, full of sound and fury, signifying nothing.
So you may have been able to tell that scene frustrated me a little bit, because indeed they go into voiceover for a monologue soliloquy and come out of it. Like, they start off not in voiceover, and then they go into it, and they come back out of it. And it's not that long of a speech, so, like, why he felt the necessary, like, at some point, that was just Polanski justifying his own decision to do that for the rest of the movie. Like, and Finch is clearly a capable actor. Why not just let Finch do some of these lines? Like, what kind of decision was that? That said, I think Finch did a good job at the start. He has a little burst of anger, and then it goes on. He gives up such that by the time he gets to the out-out brief candle, he says it as quickly and, you know, as sullenly as anybody said it, out-out brief candle. And so that was an interesting take. He goes, yeah, very start, clearly get a little mad, and then he just gives up by the end. I don't think that one was a very utterly compelling scene, but I don't think that's Finch's fault. I think that's more than anybody Polanski and the stupid voiceover stuff. I don't know, folks. What do you guys think? Go ahead and...
I think Magneto did it best.
Yeah, which Magneto? Yeah, which Magneto? It wasn't Professor X. And maybe I don't know, James McAvee has a version out there somewhere, and you can say which Professor X, too. Ooh. Let us know in the comments if there's anyone that you think is particularly better than another, if you don't think any of them are any good, if you think all of them are great.
If you know the best one.
Yeah, if there's one that we didn't include that's from another famous movie or theatrical version, give that a shout out. And if you liked this sort of edition of our video, let us know, because there are other monologues and there's other scenes in Shakespeare that have multiple takes, and we could do some more reaction videos like this. Thanks for watching, guys. Stay tuned for more videos coming out. We're going to finish our Philip Sidney Defense of Poetry stuff soon. Hopefully going to do a live reading of maybe some texts like The Malcontent by John Marston, or The Tempest by Shakespeare, or maybe even Macbeth by Shakespeare, or maybe even The Alchemist by Ben Jonson, and maybe some other video ideas. So stay tuned for those. Like, subscribe, share, visit our Patreon if you're so inclined. And otherwise,
Nullius in verba.